All right, as folks get set up, welcome. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining another session of the Media Education Lab's II in the Classroom series. As we go through today's conversations, feel free to introduce yourself in the chat, come off mute, ask questions in the chat, and feel free to be very interactive. That's what this is meant to be. In this session, we're going to talk about how AI is transforming education, personalizing learning, automating assessment, improving collaboration. Dr. Ian O'Byrne is going to be our guide for this discussion. He's an associate professor of literacy education at the College of Charleston in South Carolina. And he also authors a great weekly newsletter that focuses on the intersections between technology, education, and literacy. So as folks come in, Ian, please do take it away. And I'll look forward to seeing everyone's names and places in the chat.
Welcome, everybody. Thanks for allowing me to be here. I appreciate you taking your time on a busy slash restful holiday week. Hopefully all is well around you. Hopefully you're taking time to say hi to human beings around you and reach out to loved ones. And the weather's not too crazy, which it is definitely here. In the chat, I put a link to the blog post with my materials. I also have a slide deck here. So please, at any point, unmute. Feel free to raise your hand in the chat or put text into the chat. Cry blasphemy at any point. More discussion is better than less. With these brilliant minds that we have on the call right now, I think there's a great opportunity to try and unpack some of this, some of the challenges and opportunities that we have here. So I'm going to try and move you to one of the screens here and pay attention. Natasha, I see you in there. Hopefully you have our manuscript submission that we sent out. We were talking about that the other day, and I was like, I don't know if they got that thing or not. Just making sure that I had that out. You got it? All right, good.
Yeah, very excited. We got some great submissions, so we'll send out notifications next week.
Good.
On the DQ, you're in.
So I'm going to go and share my screen. Let's see if I can get this done. I'll share the browser tab. I know that we're all educators, so I think that we can handle looking at a browser screen and look at the behind the scenes of the Google Doc. I put the post out there so that we can take a look at where we're going. This is obviously on my blog, and I'll share, I have shared more of my insight in there or some of my thoughts as I unpack what's going on. And so that links to a lot of the other things that I've been thinking and playing with, but the actual slide deck is here. And so let me see if I hit play, it will actually work. So is it showing the full screen for everybody? Sweet.
That's good.
So I want to talk a little bit about what we might be able to do with these machine learning generative technologies, get a sense of what you're thinking and feeling and where is your headspace right now. And so I see a lot of great names piling up in the chat. My name is Ian O'Byrne. As I said before, I'm an associate professor of literacy here at the College of Charleston. I build and break things online frequently when it comes to technology. I'm very intrigued. Intrigued is the word that I'll use when I think about these generative technologies and think about what we could and should do with them. And then some of my digital footprints are available there. When we think about what we're going to talk about today, I think most of this focuses on potential. There are opportunities that we have. My thoughts are that there are discussions that we need to have. I'm thankful for the Media Lab to sponsor these discussions. I think these discussions need to be more inter and transdisciplinary so we can get a better sense of what could and should happen. My concern is that I sense a lot of hysteria and hyperbole about these technologies. And I think that, you know, we need to take time and think about what could and should this mean for what's happening in our classrooms. So today, what I want to do is talk a little bit about what is this topic that we're talking about, and then give you two examples of work that I've been doing over the last couple months, and then wrap up with some of the problematic questions that keep me up at night. And by all means, this hopefully will be more of a discussion and less of a webinar or a lecture. Nobody has time for that. I am far more intrigued by what you're thinking and feeling. So at any point, feel free to stop me. And as a relatively good educator, as evidenced by my teacher evaluations, I'll stop periodically to see if people want to chime in and give some feedback. So with that, people are listing your names and affiliations in the chat. Can you please just type in, or feel free to unmute, and give me a couple words about how you're feeling about AI, how you're thinking about these generative technologies? Yeah, Katie McNamara says in the chat that most of the people that are actually playing with these things don't have as much of that doom and gloom. I was in a, I'll talk about this in a minute. I was in a hackathon from CMU and University of Tartu, and interacting with doc students and others that are actually doing a lot of this. And there's not a lot of the fear factor involved. Maybe there should be, but there isn't. Transformative, exciting, a lot of fun, absolutely. Catherine, that's one of the areas that I would love to explore is, I do a lot of work looking at youth and adolescents and how they interact with tech. We have a couple of really fun pubs out there, but what I would love to do is sit in a middle grades or a high school classroom and play with kids and see what they can create and what they want to do with these technologies. And just get out of the way and see what we can build. Curious, paradigm shifting. We'll see if it's paradigm shifting. Curious, critical, and exploring. A lot of us are curious. Confused, same here, absolutely. A lot of confusions. Yeah, Barbara says just another tool. One of the points that I hope that we make today is that a lot of these technologies have been here, and at the same time, we should have had a lot of discussions about what technology means in and out of our classrooms. You know, we should have had these discussions about, you know, the internet and new literacies, digital lit, media lit previously. Many did not. We should have had more discussion about, look at the pandemic, our use of video, our use of Zoom in and out of our classrooms. We should have had more discussion about what this means or could mean for our classrooms. Most of us did not. I mean, the people in this call did, but many others did not. Karen, not optimistic, sweet. What else do we have here? Yeah, it's not, definitely not magic. There's no silver bullets here. A petting zoo, I'm gonna go there. All right, I'm on this. I'm saving that. Oh, sweet, thank you so much. This is why we do these things. Yeah, Katie agreed. I was hoping that this would be, I have a pub or two out about, like, you know, things that we should have learned post-COVID and everything else. But I think that there's the need to focus on what could and should happen with this. So please continue to share those. I am appreciative of those that are here. A couple caveats. One, as we talk about these technologies, perfect point, Mom, Michael. As we think about these technologies, especially AI, generative AI, machine learning, LLMs, all these different acronyms that we're going to throw around. Sadly, we try to dump this onto a ChatGPT. Let's ban ChatGPT. One of the things is, with these discussions, we could either go super, super deep and super philosophical, or we can stay surface level. That's one of the challenges and opportunities, but one of the challenges that sometimes we get bogged down in the super, super deep, super theoretical. epistemological questions about what this means. And we could definitely go there. But we have to understand that, you know, we have to make a decision about which way we're going to head. So what we're going to talk about is that AI, artificial intelligence, is an umbrella term that is asking machines, allowing machines, creating machines that will perform these tasks that normally require human intelligence. If we expand that, we're looking at the field of machine learning. That's use of these algorithms. If you've not done a lot of work in computational thinking, we know that an algorithm is a rule or a recipe in order for the machine to understand what you're asking it to do and replicate that. So machine learning is using the algorithm to, Donna's here. Well, thank you, Donna. So machine learning is an opportunity, is the field that develops and uses algorithms and models to allow computer systems to learn and adapt without needing to follow specific instructions. We're going to talk a little bit about natural language processing. We're thinking about AI and computer science and folding in linguistics to think about processing and decoding human language. Most of us know and understand that syntactic information, the rules and structure and the grammar, the mechanics of language, that's relatively easy for computational thinking and computer science to plug into, because computers like structure and they like rules, and humans aren't often very good at that. And so the computer needs an opportunity to think through what does this mean and how do we interact. Most of what we're going to talk about today is generative AI. And I would urge us all to focus on generative AI and not throw out terms like ChatGPT. We'll talk about that in a minute. But think about generative AI. We'll even look at LLMs. We'll look at different pieces there. But focusing more on the science and the technology behind it and not as much on specific tools. When we think about generative AI, there's a lot of different tools that are out there. Most of us have dealt with large language models, LLMs, and chatbots. Some of us have played with image generators. We're starting to see really sophisticated video generation tools, audio generation tools. Those of you that like doing research on affinity spaces and checking out where people are hanging out online, it's really fascinating how you see these communities that they're creating pieces using image generation tools and sharing them. So they're making like digital art or riffs of digital art and sharing them with others. And there's interesting communities are bubbling up around these, you know, manufactured images or visual pieces. Audio generation tools are really fascinating. There's a couple of tools that I've been playing around with that I can give a tool audio of my voice through my podcast or YouTube videos or lectures that my students don't pay attention to. I can give audio of that to a tool and then just type out what I want the tool to say, and it will create a generated voice that sounds like me, has the same self-deprecating humor and everything else, and it will create that audio podcast. The video generation tools are also super interesting, especially as they branch out into gaming, and we can definitely talk about that. As we think about this, some of the tools that we've used and some of the tools that you've used previously and you're well aware of. So one of the ones that has, you know, caught the world by fire at the end of November, end of December, is ChatGPT, obviously. Keep in mind that ChatGPT is a product. It is a product by OpenAI. It is a product by a company. OpenAI has a long history of connections with different founders. OpenAI, as of recent, meaning the last, I think, half a dozen years, has been heavily funded by Microsoft. That's why we're seeing more OpenAI products folded into Microsoft. But it's important to remember that OpenAI is a company. It is called Open Open used to mean a lot more than it does now. That's problematic. That's something that we need to talk about. Keep in mind that ChatGPT is also a sandbox. It is a playground by OpenAI. So OpenAI, as they were getting ready for GPT 3.5 and GPT 4, they decided, let's create a sandbox so that our LLM, large language model, can play in that. Because one of the ways that these models learn is that we give them a ton of data. And so previously we would give them data from Wikipedia or Reddit or the Google book scanning or other sources. And that will take us to a certain extent, but we really ramp things up if we can provide illogical, ill-structured queries, tons of different random information, tons of different languages, folding in multimodal information. Those of us that have been doing research in multimodality, now's our time. And so it's interesting seeing how we fold, this ill-formed, illogical information in. And so that's the birthplace of ChatGPT. It's a playground. It's a sandbox. And it really is an older model of GPT. Bing is basically fueled by a lot of the work by OpenAI because they've been funding it. We see Clippy is there, obviously. One of the interesting things is those of us, or our colleagues that want to like ban ChatGPT. I think that ship has sailed. I think that, a lot of our institutions are primarily Microsoft run. And so we've already seen, these folded into Bing in the Edge browser, and we're seeing it fold into our Office products. And so very soon we'll see that line blurring between what was human created and what was created by others. Bard is Google's product. I'm not as interested and intrigued by Bard up till now. I think the Bard, the AI smarts that are in Google Docs are interesting. I think that Google, they have a leg up because they have a lot of, a lot of data about us and a lot of data about the web. A lot of that data is antiquated. So my personal thoughts, this will be a future blog post, my personal thoughts about Google searching and search engine mechanics and stuff like that is, I think, null and void. I think critical evaluation of online information, my dissertation, online reading comprehension, what my lab was involved in, for the most part, I would suggest a lot of that is antiquated, if not null and void. I think that the way we interact and find and search and evaluate information online has completely changed. And then Claude is the one that's most interesting to me. Out of all of these, my areas of interest lie in a lot of the open source LLMs and models that are out there. I frequently hang out in Hugging Face and Google Colab and LangChain we'll talk about in a minute. I'm interested in those models that I can run on my own computer or I can share in an online tool, a Python, like Colab. And you can test these things out and run them on your own machines. And then also, as I said, as we'll talk about in a minute, allow access to your own data. So you could have like a co-pilot or a guide on the side that knows what you write and what you think and what you feel. So with Claude, it is by Anthropic. It's their in-house model. We're seeing a lot of this plugged into a lot of the tools that we use. So as an example, I think we're not going to get to, we are at a place where you used to be able to buy a clock, an alarm clock for your house or an oven for your kitchen. And now if you want, you can pay a little bit more for something that's not Internet of Things compatible or not a phone or a clock or an oven that connects to the internet. Now you're going to pay a little bit more or you're going to expect a service that folds in a little bit of AI or machine learning into what it currently does. So if you use Notion as a way to collect notes and keep track of your ideas, as that public-private space, Notion has a pretty decent AI tools that fold in. I use another tool called Obsidian, and I fold in some AI tools to make sense of that. With all this, it can be pretty complex. And so one of the books that I'm in love with right now is Katie Crawford's Atlas of AI. I don't know if anybody's read that in the chat. Wonderful text. And one of the pieces, one of the points that Kate makes at the beginning of this is looking at these tools in these spaces as an atlas. And so when we think about AI, it's important to recognize that an atlas, it's a scientific text. It is a way to give us some understanding of connections in the world. It's a, we have scales and ratios. We have components that give us an understanding of form and consistency. An atlas gives us an understanding of where we might go. But also there's a lot involved in an atlas or the construction of an atlas and maps that are subjective, political. There's a little bit of the human creativity along with the scientific. So that's been the best way for me to think about this, is thinking about myself sitting in my middle school social studies class in Jersey growing up and seeing the map of, the world, and I would see the Soviet Union is this gigantic red blob that was always sitting over top of the US, and thinking about how much messaging is involved in that and how much is creative, how much is real, how much is subjective. And so for now, that is, a reference point that has made a lot of sense for me. So some of the pros and some of the cons. So one of the nice things here is that these tools are very good at summarizing knowledge. I consume a lot of podcasts. I read a lot of books on my Kindle. I listen to a lot of audiobooks. I watch a lot of YouTube videos. It does a very good question. The map is not the territory. Let me think about that for a minute. So it's very good at summarizing, making sense of what you've consumed. If you are like me at all, you read a lot of books and then 5 minutes later, you forget what you read, or you listen to a podcast and you forget the 10 things that you're like, I need to remember that later. So one of the things I use in my note-taking tools is an opportunity to quickly summarize and get the major points. One of the things that a lot of these LLMs are very, very good at is tools like Parrot or Otter does it to a certain extent, but tools that will listen to a Zoom chat like this and at the end of it give you a transcript and say, here's the important points of that meeting that you're in, and here's the deliverables that you need to take care of at a later date. Pros, correction, and improvement of existing writing. At the bottom there, I have my post that I sent out to the conversation a month or two ago. One of the things that I learned in writing for the conversation is that I have a lot of jargon in my writing. I write to speak to a specific audience, and the conversation was not happy with the way that I was writing. And so it was a challenge for me to go back and remove a lot of the jargon and a lot of the expectations, a lot of the ways that I write, because I'm writing to you, that a normal person, or at least what conversation defined as a normal person, would not appreciate. These LLMs are fantastic at generating new ideas. I think that they provide us opportunities to think more deeply, but also expand and figure out where this might head. Some of the issues with it, these LLMs will hallucinate. Okay. They are trying to predict what that next sentence, what that next word is going to be. They will lie and invent sources. Earlier I said these machines learn by looking at previous data and having humans interact. One of the things that we've noticed lately, or that has been happening, is OpenAI, the group behind Sam Altman, the group behind OpenAI, indicated they're starting to use synthetic data. So it's far easier for them just to construct a lot of fake information and pump it in the system so the system can learn. there are limitations to the model. So computing power is limiting this. We have most of what we're seeing is, and I will bring this up at the end of this, a lot of this data is obviously built on the English language. So for those of us that think it's problematic that we privilege standard academic English, this is one of these pieces that we have to think about is how much strictly English language is involved in there. Once again, AI is technical and social practices. It includes politics, it includes culture, it includes a lot of, what makes us human beings. Z, do you want to talk a little bit about the map is not the territory? And Jeffrey, you want to unmute for a minute and expand on that?
Sure. Hi, this is Z. And it popped into my head because I remember thinking about this. I remember reading it, and then I just did a quick look up to see where it came from. A mathematician came up with that metaphor that how we perceive reality is a map of reality, and it's our perception as opposed to what is actually happening. And there was something that you said about AI and what it creates from our input to it that, yeah, I don't know. It just made me think of the perception. Does AI have perception? But clearly it picks up things to represent and other things it doesn't, like standardized English versus lots of different Englishes, perhaps. That's what I got.
No, that's fascinating because a lot of this is, I've been thinking a lot about embodied cognition and thinking a lot lately about cognition and human cognition and consciousness. I've been doing a lot of thinking and reading about theory of mind lately. We have some AI tools that are getting tested against, what would a sixth grader or what would a fifth grader do in a classroom? So it's really interesting to think about what are our thoughts about cognition and consciousness and human perception and what we're perceiving about what these tools are doing or not. Any other points on that, Jeffrey?
I'll just add one more thing, which is in general, you could think of that as basically saying that all models are wrong.
Yeah.
So a map being a model leaves some things out and emphasizes some other things. And that's why we build models to simplify the world, but there's always errors. And it's interesting to think about that in terms of generative AI, because the idea of hallucinations where it's making mistakes. And some people have raised the issue of as it gets better, people will be more likely to believe anything it says, which is going to be a problem since it will never be completely accurate.
Yeah. And that's part of the, these technologies are not new. These technologies have been around for some time. As a doc student, we would look at online reading comprehension and, you would type into Google or into your browser, what is the height of Mount Fuji, as my advisor would like to ask, or ask a question about Britney Spears. Thankfully, Britney Spears is back again, so now my jokes are not lost. But you think about these queries, and now Google, previously, a decade ago or more, Google would would pop in and give you auto-suggest, okay? Your Netflix queue, your Amazon purchases, your Kindle reads, like these algorithms have been following us and paying attention for a long time. And now, thanks to these generative technologies, now the opportunity to really see what they could and should do and do something about that. So in a way, this is very empowering that we have, to a certain extent, we have more control over this. One of the questions, one of the comments in there from Charles about AI in China, one of the interesting things is looking at the different companies that are behind these tools and these technologies, but then also, you know, I think that we need to pay attention to the money, the ideologies, the purpose, the audience, what these tools are for. I prefer to pay attention to a lot of the open source tools so I can get a sense of what's happening behind there, or at least people far smarter than I can get a sense of what's happening with the tools. But then at the same time, I'm really interested to see what happens if and when, you know, an individual will interact with a generative tool and that tool doesn't espouse the same ideologies that they do. Meaning if I'm anti-vaxxer or I don't believe in science or I believe the world is flat or I think that pineapple's okay on pizza, I might interact with that tool and that generative tool might come back and say, well, no, you're wrong. Then what happens when you have the machine that is basically conflicting with the worldview or the ideology of that human, that perception of the human being? Interestingly, and there's a paper out recently by researchers at Stanford, the machine will back down. The machine will be like, well, actually, you're probably right. Like, yeah, 2 + 2 = 3. I was all wrong the whole time. So it's really interesting to see how we interact with these devices and these tools. I want to show you two examples of things that I've been working on lately to get some insight from all of you and hopefully spark more discussion. So please keep the chat coming and we'll have people unmute and explain things. So I work in teacher education. I help train future teachers. I regularly teach a language and literacy course. This is for middle grade secondary students. This past semester, I would go into class and I would play with these technologies just the way that I said earlier that I'd like to get a better sense of what you think about this. I would play with these technologies with my pre-service teachers. They are undergraduates. And I try to get a sense of like what they think about these technologies. So one day I went into my language and lit class and I asked my middle grade secondary teachers, okay, has anybody here used ChatGPT, you know, AI tools, stuff like that? Juniors and seniors predominantly in the class in higher ed. And a lot of them said no. And then I said, you've all sort of missed the beat here. As I was talking with them, I pulled up, this is ChatGPT. I was talking to one of my social studies high school teachers, and I said, what's an assignment that you just had students? No, it was an assignment that the student had in one of their history classes here. I said, you know, you were just writing a paper about war and society. And so I just typed this in and let it go on the projector in class. And it was interesting seeing students' faces drop. That it just spit out a 5-paragraph essay about that. So I reflected with students a little bit. I said, well, what do you think about this? And this is all pre-service, middle grade, secondary teachers. What was really interesting is a lot of the students in the class automatically said, people that would use this, students that use this, they're either cheaters or lazy. Okay. Relatively diverse class. And what ended up happening is that several of the students in class started to indicate that they were not lazy, that they, in K-12, they learned hard how to read and write. And they especially learned how to write essays. And that they, you know, were in command of standard academic English. And that they learned that in middle school, high school. They learned that in K-12, and they needed that now in higher ed. I asked, is there anything else that they learned in middle school, high school, and in K-12 other than writing essays, please, as an English teacher? And they said, yes, of course, but writing essays and communicating in standard academic English was one of the major pieces. And the students indicated, pre-service teachers, that their job was to make sure that students could be functionally literate in society. And that if students in their class were using this to pump out essays, tools like that, they've missed the boat and that they were cheaters or lazy. Okay. So that's interesting. And then I pulled up a different tool, WriteSonic, ChatSonic. I love WriteSonic. I love ChatSonic. It tends to work a little bit better for me than earlier versions of than GPT, ChatGPT, and I'll put WriteSonic and ChatSonic in the chat. But as I was reflecting with students, one of my science teachers, a bio teacher, indicated that they were teaching a class earlier that day about forensic science to a high school bio class. The student indicated that it went well, but they felt a little bit apprehensive because the high school bio teacher, the cooperating teacher for the classroom, is an expert in forensic science. And so they were upset that the teacher had far more cool stories about forensic science than they did. And so I said, oh, that's interesting. So as the student is reflecting and other students are chiming in, I open up WriteSonic, I open up ChatSonic, and I said, can you write me a lesson plan about forensic science? Hit go. It pumps out the whole lesson plan in front of the class for the student. And then I said, hey, WriteSonic, can you mentioned a handout. Can you create that handout for me? It pumps out the handout right there. And then I said, interesting. Okay, so students are talking, students are reflecting, and as this is going on, this is all dropping itself out there. And then I said, you mentioned a PowerPoint. Can you give me the PowerPoint as well? So WriteSonic, ChatSonic is like, sure, here's your PowerPoint. Okay. And so as I'm doing this, I see, especially the student that was teaching that forensic science class, I really wish I would have had this. Okay. Really wish I would. I wish I had this last week when I needed to turn in a lesson plan, all my materials to my university supervisor or the cooperating teacher, or whatever. I really wish that I had this. And then some of the other students in the class started to push back against the original, you know, groups of students that said, look, you know, this might be a opportunity to level the playing field for non-native English speakers, students with special needs, students that might not be experts in forensic science. These tools might be a way to help support other students, people that might struggle. And so the way I left it with my students, and the way I would leave it with you before I open the mics and we all can respond, that you know, I think this is an opportunity to provide some scaffolding for folks that might be struggling. So as a pre-service teacher, I think there's the opportunity to say, hey, can you give me a start of a PowerPoint slide deck, or can you give me these opportunities and to get me off and running? And, you know, good teachers borrow, great teachers modify, get started there. And then that is a jumping off point. But there is the opportunity too, as they build up skill in pedagogy and thinking about teaching, learning, assessment, there is the opportunity to build that up with these tools. So I'm going to stop for a minute and feel free to unmute. What are your thoughts about this little experiment with my students?
This is Kathy Resnicek. I teach both teachers who are, I work in K-12, but I also teach at university. So we've done this with both teachers that are currently in the classroom and pre-service teachers. And it is fairly similar to your experience. When it's a student using it, quote unquote, then sometimes it's like, oh, I'm not sure about that. But then when you show them what it can do for them, then all of a sudden, magically, it becomes such an amazing tool. Then we have conversations about, well, how can this still be a tool for students? What are the things that we need to be working with our students on and using this more effectively, right? And I see a lot of people in the chat talking about editing, modifying. You know, you can't just take this, you know, verbatim. You've got to do some some research. You got to do some rewriting. You've got to do, but I find it's, for me, it's that great. It's great at getting past that initial writer's block or whatever, if you have that, you know, it is throw it out. And I end up usually modifying or changing most of it, but it gets me past the blank page stage, which I think in some places is hard for people.
Yeah, I think, I mean, you know, we, you know, I won't speak for other people on this call. I have spent a lot of time polishing my writing and my thinking. You know, I still have colleagues that you know, that I would give anything just to see how they edit and how they write and how they think and how they organize. And I recognize the fact that most of what I do doesn't work, and that I could write better, and I rely on jargon and tired tropes. And so a way to get, you know, to think more clearly and succinctly about my writing, especially, is helpful to me. Other thoughts?
Ian, this is Donna Elberman, and I was wondering in your study if the teachers, not the students, but the teachers' perceptions of what their students know and are likely to demonstrate in their classes. Do you have any data on that?
I think most of it are, I mean, as with all teacher programs, I think that, you know, at that point, when students take this class, they're in their first or second semester out of three or four semesters. So it really is a track meet. I don't believe that our students really learn how to teach and connect with students and differentiate until they get out in the classroom and they see real live students. So I think at this point, they're still trying to get their feet wet with, how do I, you know, what is teaching and learning all about? How do I feel about my personality or my identity as an educator? In this class specifically, I'm also trying to chip away at, you know, when I teach my language and lit class, I try to problematize their thinking about what is language and what is literacy and what is text. And think about and chip away at how they might privilege some forms of text and versions of text over others. So I don't think they're there yet. They're, to a certain extent, just from students that are out in the fields and come back, there is a lot of focus on like deficit perspectives of what students can and cannot do in the classroom. But I think a lot of that is just, they're just getting into the classroom and just getting their feet wet. It would be interesting to, you know, conduct the same sort of work with a classroom teacher or two, or work in a district and look at, you know, grab a handful of instructors or K-12 teachers and say, okay, we're going to invest in you and give you latitude to test out these tools and see what they can do and see what they create and how they reimagine what's happening. Same thing in higher ed, same thing with youth. So I much more work needs to be done.
Okay. Thank you.
So I'm going to show you another example of something that I've been working on. So recently, and by recently, I mean now, I've been involved. Carnegie Mellon's running with University of Tartu is running a hackathon. I have a lot of the links in here, and it's in the slide deck. Let me just pull it up. So if you go to, so the hackathon info is available. I'll drop this in the chat because you're going to want it. Well, most of this stuff is no longer happening. The invited works, I would definitely check out a lot of the talks. So you can go down and you can look at a lot of the previous talks that have happened. And one of the things that was in the chat earlier indicated that the folks that are actually doing the developing and working with these tools their view of what this could and should mean for society is vastly different from the rest of us. So I think it's worth going through and checking out some of the keynotes and some of the discussions that they've had. A lot of great Daphne's workshop using CoLab and other tools and using Python was fantastic. Excellent teacher, learned a lot, had to watch the YouTube video 4 or 5 times and work through a couple times. So it's like I'm back in my stats classes. But I would definitely recommend it. So they are in the middle of a series of hackathons. So there's one on medicine and health. I was involved in the one on education and future of work. And then there's one that's currently happening on finance and economics. I'm also involved in that one. A friend of mine is a forensic accountant for the government. And so what we're looking at is ways to build financial literacy and have different AI tools that can support individuals. But what I want to do is I want to show you what I've created for the education and future of work piece that we had. So let me go back to, I don't know why it's giving me this version. Yeah, we'll stay there. So one of the things that's interesting is I went into this hackathon and I wanted to use AI to create a situated simulated learning assessment. And what I mean by that is I think with our students, we can focus on the content, but there is a need to have our students sort of walk the walk and talk the talk. And so what I did is I wanted to create a tool that could allow students to interact in a virtual space, a simulated space, so that they could talk with other individuals. And so this, to a certain extent, has already been done. So Stanford came out with this paper about generative agents, and I'll put that in the chat as well. So the gist of this is that you'd have students that would, if you think about a video game, in a video game, you have NPCs, non-player combatants, they're virtual characters, and you'd interact with those virtual characters. My kids play Animal Crossing, and so you go over to a character and you talk, and they have a little bit of communication back and forth with you. A lot of it is just scripted out. But we're seeing the use of AI tools, generative LLM tools that can have these things interact like human beings. And so I started to think about, well, what would happen if we, once again, I am in teacher education, what would happen if I created a tool that could allow folks to go into a virtual classroom and teach individuals? And so they could work with students virtually. Okay. So let me get back up to that. So what we did was I put out an initial pitch. Sorry for that. And my idea was to have that situated environment. What we ultimately did, and by we, I mean myself and a grad student at CMU, is looked at the use of LangChain. So LangChain allows you to create your own LLMs, your own virtual models. And most importantly, you can give it access to your files and your data. So one of the things I love about LangChain is I can run an instance of an AI tool and use LangChain, and I'll explain what LangChain is in a minute, and give it access to like all of my writings ever or all of my notes ever. And now I can have a virtual assistant that knows what I've written and knows what I've thought and knows my lousy drafts for manuscripts and knows researcher notes and knows, things that I could have written, but I didn't. But also LangChain and some of these LLMs have the capacity to not forget like I do. And so as I write and as I think and as I blog and write my newsletters, I can have an assistant that says, hey, you should think about this. And as Katie says, you got to feed him. And so what we're thinking about is you know, LangChain, once again, it's a framework. You can use it for chatbots, generative AI, stuff like that. And so Ikram revised this idea chat platform that we developed. And I can show you to basically create a series of bots or agents in a room. So it's relatively simple right now because it's all text-based. That annoys me. I want to create a tool that you can see and talk to and hear the other individuals. I would love to create a virtual middle school classroom to have my students go see what it really is like to teach eighth grade. But they already have it in place so you can write, you can type out, you can text individuals to see what they would do. So different use case scenarios for this, okay? And in the link I share, and I will give it back to you, I'll share the tool so you can play with it. Different use case scenarios. One, kid is a K-12 student sitting in a classroom. There's a project-based learning framework that the teacher uses. It's all open-ended, student inquiry driven. They might try and solve a wicked problem like climate change. A K-12 student or a team of students could use a tool like this to have a couple agents, a couple bots that know what they've been thinking and writing and doing, and they can be that support and guide on the side. Because some of our students in K-12, some of our students in higher ed, they want somebody else to look at their work before you, the classroom teacher, the instructor, look at it. So they want a little bit of feedback, perhaps critical feedback, to improve upon that. Another use case scenario is a classroom teacher. So one of my areas of interest was that classroom teacher, that K-12 teacher that is preparing to teach a lesson to a student or a group of students. They might want to have more insight into supporting students with special needs, English language learners. Sometimes in our heads, we have a vision of how the words are going to sound as they come out, and then students don't really get what we're putting down. There's an opportunity to make more sense of this. And lastly, is one of the key things is, we needed to, through this hackathon, we needed to pitch our ideas. So you could see an opportunity where you might have an idea for a class or for an idea or a project, and you sort of pitch it, and you want somebody to come in that generally supports and understands and gets what you're trying to do, and somebody completely outside of your field that doesn't understand what you're talking about and will give you critical feedback. Thankfully, I had that with my dissertation. My father was an attorney for years, and so I'd read my drafts with him, and he would, push back, when I would have too much jargon and I didn't make sense of my writing. So how do you do this? You have the individual, the user, the student is there. You can dial up one, two more generative agents, bots, that would be able to access all of the prior student work and make sense of that, and then provide more questions and more feedback. I'll stop talking for a minute, and I'll put the link to the tool. I'll link to Ikram's piece first, and I'll put that in the chat, and then I'll put this through. Thoughts and questions? Thank you, Mariana. So if you want to play with this at a later date, I see that you're on mute, Donna. If you want to play with it at a later date, you can go to IdeaStorm. You can open up that API and give the API key from OpenAI and then create different bots. And what's interesting is then you go in and you say, okay, agent one, this one is Donna. And Donna is, you put out, model student, always believes in what I'm saying. And then model two, this is Ian. This is a more critical individual that's going to critique. And then you basically say go, and they'll just start up and they'll start talking. Yeah, Z has a question in there about what about social learning? It's an area of my research right now is computational thinking, but embedded with existing at the same time with computational thinking is computational participation. So I think one of the questions that we have to ask and answer is, what is it, what's the role of the human being in these? And the peer tutors piece, no, not passe at all. I think with that, one of the ways that I would use that in my classroom is what we said before in the chat. I'd want to go back and look at the script with my students and reflect on what they did and said. My thought is to create an environment, a virtual environment. So students of mine that might be a little bit apprehensive about going into the classroom and talking about race or privilege or identity, or, you know, they would have a virtual space to talk about it. And then now I can go to real human beings and talk about it. And I've sort of like got my bumps and bruises out in the virtual space. So Pamela, what they're doing is they're using a large language model you can plug into. So it's your own version, a limited version of what you can do with Anthropic's Claude or OpenAI, but you have the access. You can plug it into an OpenAI key if you want. So in there, I give it my API for OpenAI. I know it's acronym hell right now, but it's basically a way to tie into what's happening. I'm going to end with a couple of wicked problems, and then I'm more than willing to sit around and chat for a little bit. So here's what's keeping me up at night. There's a famous post from a Google exec back in the day that talked about the maker-manager schedule, and that we should, instead of scheduling our days so that we are managing and we're going in and out of meetings and in and out of Zoom meetings and managing our time and managing the time of others, we should block off time in our day so that we make, that we create. We do what makes us human. And so thinking about these tools, it seems like we're building a future where a marketing firm, instead of hiring 10 or 20 brilliant people that are going to create new plans, now we're moving to a space where I have friends, you know, that talked about this recently. We're moving to a space where we're going to hire two or three people that are really, really good at parsing out content to pump into the tools. And then the tools tell us what to do. And then these managers sort of make space of, they provide space to give their boss the best of the best. Okay. So one of my questions is, as we move to this, who is the maker and who is the manager? You know, who's in charge of whom? Another question that I have is thinking through, good point, Jeffrey. One of the questions that I have is thinking about data literacy and algorithmic literacies. It's very important that we understand the companies that are involved, the money involved, the tools that are involved, and the data as we use these tools. I have a link there. The Beijing Consensus on AI came out from UNESCO. They're asking for responses. I have a response that I wrote with Doug Belshaw and Tom. Tom is in there. So you can click on those links and see. But I'm more thoughtful about what should K-12 teachers, what should K-12 students be thinking about and doing. And lastly, keep in mind that these AI tools, they were built by human beings. They were built by human beings using human intelligence, okay? And so this information was scraped from the internet, now it's being manufactured, but this is human information and intelligence and digital residue that's been left behind. And now we've created tools that have learned from that and are sort of recreating that and restructuring it, okay? And that involves all of the social, political, cultural, economic, historical forces that impacted what we've learned and done and created over time. And now we're just remixing it and regurgitating it. And so it asks questions about colonialization, about individuals, about how we sort of like foist these ideologies on a global community. And to that, I'll stop talking because I know there's a lot of chat that's been going on. So questions. And I'll share all of the links for everything that we've talked about. I continue to play with these things and blog about them. So questions, what are you thinking? What are you feeling?
I'll go. I'm just, I'm struggling to think about how I'm going to integrate this into my fall semester, as I didn't last semester for a variety of reasons. But I'm thinking about how to introduce it without falling into the sort of moral panic thing. But then also, you know, how do you get students to engage with it and see it as a useful tool rather than, like I said before, just this sort of moral panic about it, which I tend to shut out when people are, shouting too loudly.
Yeah. I mean, one of the ways that I love integrating technology into my classes is I let students play. You know, I think that when we have students that we teach computer science or we scratch or coding in our classroom or Minecraft, you know, very little happens, or having them create PowerPoints or websites. I just give a general 5-10 minutes and then let them go. I've also learned a lot just asking my students if they're using it or not. So last semester I taught a class on Gamergate and gaming, and it was freshmen. And then I taught a class, my language and lit class. And the freshman class was really, really interesting. You know, beginning of the semester, how many are using ChatGPT and stuff? None, except for this one. And these were computer science students. One was telling me about how they have it create their essays for their first year writing experience and then pump it through two or three other tools to obfuscate the writing. And so that it wouldn't get picked up by all the bots and scanning tools. And as the student's explaining that, two or three other students are like, shh, don't tell, don't tell. And I'm like, well, I'm sort of asking. So I'm not going to report you to anyone, considering I'm asking you what you're doing. But yeah, Joyce.
Yeah, Natasha, I've been doing a lot of thinking about this as well. And I've been doing a whole lot of workshops, as many of us have. I'm working on guidelines for my students. And at the bottom of that petting zoo are collected guidelines across disciplines. And I think it's important to kind of recognize this is going to look different depending upon what we teach. Mm-hmm. We're going to have to ask some deep questions. What does it mean to be creative? What will the jobs that we're preparing you for look like in 5 years? I had conversations with a writing teacher a couple of weeks ago who discovered what we've been trying a bunch of different tools, but one of her assignments was to have her students write a sonnet. And in the petting zoo, the sonnet that she created using the parameters that she described, I don't remember whether it was a Shakespearean or Spenserian or Shakespearean sonnet. She had all of the stuff in there. She had the theme, great prompting. And it was the best sonnet she'd ever received. And she said, what does it mean to be creative? And how do we develop cultures of academic honesty in a new environment? And I think these discussions have to take place, and they have to take place for us to understand within a creative writing class, what is an acceptable use in terms of process. If we're learning how to be writers, what does that look like? If we're doing research, is that different? Are we engaging in a conversation we know nothing about? In that case, like we do with Wikipedia, we need to jump in, get context, be part of a conversation that's been going on for 50 years and find that context. I started with my grad students at the beginning of the fall semester, and we watched these things change. And I teach a course in search, and I also teach courses for pre-service educators. But in the search course, what was really interesting was this was essential. They needed to understand how search engines and tools, search tools are migrating, how academic search is changing in really dramatic ways. And they said, no, we're not touching these things. And I said, you need to teach others how to use them. You need to understand this, maybe not go deep under the hood, because that's not who we are. We're human connected people who are helping other humans use technology. And so, but they were so reluctant. And then we discovered, like, what does a reflection look like for an assessment? And I, in addition to the idea that I'm going to cite certain types of use using ALA and APA, I want to understand your process. So for every assessment I'm doing, I'm including guidelines for reflection. In what ways did you use machine tools? And did you use them for brainstorming? Did you use them to suggest resources? Did you use them to create an annotated bibliography? In what ways did you check them? How did they do? Did they fail? Were they very helpful? I want to know the process because I want to know what thinking is going on. And I want to prepare these educators to be able to go into the classroom and create new cultures of academic honesty. The research that I've done on, I hate using the word plagiarism. I like using the notion of building cultures of academic honesty because it's not about gotcha. It's about building character and building honesty. And so these things are really important to me. And so I want people to know how to reflect on what parts of this were, came out of my own creative spirit and what parts of it were prompted in other ways. And it's not plagiarism to be inspired by something, to get ideas from somewhere. It isn't academic honesty if you're using something wholesale, whether it was created by another human or through algorithmic generation that I wanna know if that's not yours, tell me. But once you set yourself up as somebody who is willing to play, who is willing to understand this stuff, who wants you to do the same and to evaluate everything, and also to be honest. Those are things that I think have to be part of our September conversations, regardless of where we teach. And there's a disciplinarity about this. In coding, it's gonna look like a very different, the ethics of it will be similar, but it'll be a different kind of conversation from writing perhaps, maybe not. I think about it very broadly. I have the guidelines I started writing and draft, Judy, I can share those with you. But I've also collected other people's guidelines and statements that are arranged relating to discipline, which you're welcome to look at. So I'm just babbling, I'm so sorry.
No, you're not. But what I love about that is, I mean, we have a history of when new technologies come out and they try to change what we do, especially in our classrooms, there is this belief, there is a mindset that students are gonna use this to cheat. This is historically what we do. Hyper-visible on Twitter, Chris talks about this much more eloquently than I, but we saw this happen with Zoom most recently, where we demanded that students put their cameras on, you know, for the Zoom calls, and we demanded that they show up for hours upon hours. Even my kindergartner was doing the same. So, you know, if one thing that we do leaving this talk is we say, you know what, maybe I'm just gonna trust students, you know, trust myself, trust other individuals and see what they do. Maybe that is one first step. You know, can we get lost in all the tools? 100%. Do all the acronyms add on to nothing, or the pay models and everything else, or the money behind it? Yeah, maybe just we begin with a little bit of trust, you know, in our students, in our colleagues, and in ourselves.
And I,
Jeffrey, well, you've had a hand. No, go ahead, Joyce.
I think we're lumping a lot of things together too. Even when we're talking about generative AI, there are rich collections and genres of different tools. And, you know, I do think that, you know, we're seeing good and bad stuff in art, in filmmaking, in script writing, in transcription. And we're also seeing, maybe it's not generative AI, but we're seeing incredible resources that support academic differences. Different ways of learning. I know we need to go behind the money, but the Microsoft tools that support reading fluency are remarkable. Mm-hmm. Reading Coach and I'm forgetting the other one, remove stigma from students reading aloud without anybody judging them, and they can practice and practice. And the AI discovers missteps for them and allows them to, would you like to do this again? And when they're finished, then they submit it to an adult who is working on, and there's stuff that is created for people who are blind and deaf. And there's just amazing generative AI up there that it actually is so inspiring. And the search tools are remarkable. They get beyond metadata to help you discover the similar researchers or researchers that you might not have found and go within the paywalls, which is one of the things that much of the generative AI is not doing. So we're not getting the students into high quality resources that they might have found previously in JSTOR or EBSCO or ProQuest or Gale products that we value. So there are other tools that will dig deeper and lead them to some of these things.
Absolutely. Bob, great question there. I have 70 things I want to say about it. Jeffrey, you've had your hand up.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention again the thing I put in the chat earlier, which is an ACM talk on using generative AI, in this case, Copilot, to teach programming. It's really quite amazing. And basically, an earlier ACM talk said the research is basically showing that using these tools increases programmers' efficiency in creating code by about 50%. And this ACM talk, I'll put it in the chat again, basically talks about how these folks are using the tools to teach students how to use them to create, their programs, and using it in CS 101 courses. And for me, it was interesting to think about, and I by no means have explored this very far, how one could leverage their approaches to teaching other subjects. So that's something to be developed, but it seems like a potentially fertile thing to explore.
We have CSPD week is coming up soon. The CSPD week initiative is surprisingly very, very robust here in South Carolina. And so I'm helping run one of the workshops on unplugged coding and computational thinking, computer science. We're teaching teaching K-12 educators how to embed computational thinking CS into their classroom. And we would have blocks of teachers, that would sign up for like the Python courses and everything. And now what we're seeing is that something like GitHub and GitHub's Copilot, you can go in and you can just have the tool create what you want. So you can go in and say, okay, I want to build a website in HTML, or I want to build a video game, and give it text-based. And it would say, great, use this code and put it into whatever tool that you're going to use. And then that coding environment. And then you come back and say, well, the code didn't do exactly what I wanted it to do. And say, oh, you got to fix this line here in the sequence. That's known as debugging. Okay. So, now there's a lot of limitations there. Okay. Is it far better off to know what Python is and how to write in Python? Absolutely. Is it better to have that mindset, those dispositions about computational thinking, computer science? Absolutely. But now we have a tool that, once again, this is a scary word, like we're leveling that playing field. What do we gain? What do we lose when anyone can sit down and say, I want to create a video game about dot, 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 and it will just give you all the code to put it into whatever tool you're going to use.
All right. I'm so sorry to jump in and cut us off. I know every one of these sessions could go for hours and hours of conversation. I'm happy to connect folks via email if you want to keep the conversation going. And I know a few folks want the chat as well, so I'll be sure to save that. And a recording of this session will also be available online. I want to thank you all. All of these sessions are always so interactive. Thank you so much for participating. And our next session will be on the 18th of this month. So I hope to see you all again very soon. Have a great day, everyone.
Thanks, all.